Welcome, everybody, to a bonus episode of the AZ LAX Report. We've got a little bit of a different twist today. Our co-host, Alex Garwood, is out tasting some great Kentucky bourbon for his belated birthday celebration. So good for Alex. We know he's having a great time out there with his family. And since it's spring break week, we had some limited ALL action. We're going to report on the scores shortly, but basically thinking, you know, this is a good time to maybe shift the podcast a little bit. We've got two new guests for this next episode. I'm going to be excited to introduce my brother, Cody Petillo, the GCU offensive coordinator. And we also get some bonus commentary by Pat Harbeson, current coach of the Brophy Broncos. And this was just about an hour time of us to kind of talk about lacrosse, talk about the state of lacrosse out here. I think we get some really good perspectives on the high school game, recruiting game. I think just a really varied, I really was happy to do this podcast, get a chance to hear from them. We do miss Alex, and we are looking forward to our next episode where we get back into our format there. But I hope everyone enjoys our interviews with this bonus episode. With that said, let's quickly run through some ALL action games just to make sure. And we've got some limited stats on this here, so we're going to make sure we at least get the scores ahead. So Tuesday night, Brophy Varsity 2 defeats West Valley 7-6. And that's a game that, again, we've got some limited stats, so we don't have too much to report on that, but want to make sure we get you the score. Nathan Bowden from West Valley with 17 saves, 17 goals against. So trying his best there to will that team to a defensive victory, but Brophy gets the win 7-6. On Thursday, Catalina Foothills host South Point there in Tucson. They end up getting a shutout with a victory 12-0 over South Point. So again, missing some stats, so don't have too much to talk about there, but shutout. So I'm going to give a shout out to the goalies for Foothills, making sure they put up the goose egg there. I want to make sure you recognize that. And then on Friday, West Valley defeats South Point 12-4. That's a most recent game here. So good job by West Valley in getting a victory over South Point, bouncing back from their loss against Brophy 2 earlier in the week. So that's pretty much all we had from the ALL standpoint. So with that said, I'm going to jump us right into about an hour of conversation with Pat and Cody. I hope everybody enjoys it. Feel free to send us some messages, emails, comments. Let us know what you think about the episode. And as always, please subscribe, share it with your friends, share it with your family, listen to it on Spotify, listen to it on YouTube. We are trying to do our best to grow the game here. So really excited to bring you this bonus episode. So enjoy our conversation with GCU offensive coordinator Cody Petillo and Brophy Prep head coach Pat Harbeson. Thanks, everybody. All right. Good morning, guys. Welcome to a bonus episode of the AZ LAX Report. We've got two guests here. Thought we'd do something a little bit different. Our co-host Alex is wandering the Kentucky Bourbon Trail, so we know he's having a good time this weekend. We are on St. Patrick's Day. Some of us here are starting the festivities a little bit early. With that said, let me introduce our guests here that we've got. First-time guest here, my brother, current offensive coordinator at GCU, Cody Petillo. Cody, how are you doing today?
Pretty good, you know. Nice, wonderful weather out here Sunday to be speaking on the pod.
Nice. Well, we're happy to have you. We actually have our first recurring guest now, current head coach of the Brophy Broncos, Pat Harbeson. Pat, how are you doing today?
Doing great. Excited to hang out with you guys, talk a little lacrosse, and, you know, have some fun.
Yeah, so, you know, we typically have a little bit of a structure. It's spring break week in the ALL, so there wasn't too much action all before this kind of go over. You heard some of the updates from that, but basically, why don't you get the boys together, kind of shoot the shit a little bit, or I guess chew the fat, I shouldn't say that if we're trying not to curse, right? And basically say, you know what, let's have a little St. Patrick's Day special and just kind of talk about lacrosse. I think you've got, both have some pretty varied backgrounds here, so we can get some good perspective. And basically, we're just going to have a little fun episode here, and hopefully the audience enjoys it. So right now, we've got Cody. You just came off a win last night with GCU. Now, the audience knows Pat. How about you give us just a little background, your experience, how you ended up out here, and then we can kind of get into some fun stuff.
Well, so obviously, like you, I'm from Long Island, New York. I played lacrosse over at Rutgers University and then ended up transferring to Hartwick College in upstate New York. Excuse me. I didn't really know what I wanted to do after I finished college, so I was looking at grad school, grad assistant positions, and our dad had a connection with the coach out here at GCU at the time, and kind of, you know, they were looking for someone to come in and be that grad assistant position, not technically a grad assistant, but kind of have that role. So I was like, you know what, why not? It was better than going to some of these other schools that I was looking at in Chicago and New Hampshire, would be really cold. So I figured I'd come out to Arizona, you know, spent two years out here as a grad assistant, and then went back home, came back out here, started coaching again, and, you know, a couple other coaching opportunities in between, and finally landed back here at GCU this past season. So
you did last year, you were an ALL focused podcast right now. You did coach at Pinnacle last year, right?
That's correct. I was at Pinnacle.
So he was a coach along with our co-host Alex Garwood over there. So excited to have you out here. You know, you've coached at a few different levels, played with, I was actually thinking about this. We've got several rings between all of us in this room right now. Like, I was trying to count. I mean, I've got two. How many do you have, Pat?
I have two
for Brophy.
Okay, so I'll backtrack. I have a national championship ring, professional lacrosse.
Oh, I wasn't counting that one.
And then two.
So four from this guy. What was your professional
high school
one?
Too, if you want.
Oh, yeah, count them all. Count them all. Jesus, I thought.
Tom Brady over here.
Yeah.
I think I had three lacrosse.
In a humble way.
Two lacrosse state championships in high school. NCAA, and then I played in the MLL with the Ohio Machine in 2017. And then two back to back with Brophy. Yep.
So six. Cody, you have GCU.
I have a coach. MCLA national championship the first year I was coaching with them. Yep.
Okay. And then I played with Tufts. We won our national championship in 2010, so Division III national championship. And little known fact, a lot of people, state championship girls lacrosse in Massachusetts.
Ooh.
So another ring there. So up to, what is that, nine rings between us here. This is a power room of lacrosse minds getting together here on a Sunday. So that's great. Pat, you coached girls lacrosse when you were out here, right? Didn't you start at ASU?
I did. No, that's not how I started. When I first moved out here I think it was December of 2016, and then I did a full year, not even knowing that lacrosse was out here. And then Miles Jones did a lacrosse camp, and he texted me. For those that don't know, Miles Jones played at Duke, and then, you know, just a PLL, all-star, and I think he's a Long Island guy, too.
Cody played against him.
Yeah.
It was Cody's year.
We did play.
Well, anyways, there was a lacrosse camp, or he was doing a lacrosse camp, and he was like, hey, man, I'm going to be out. Like, can we link up? And I was like, what are you doing out here? He's doing a lacrosse camp. I was like, I didn't even know lacrosse was out here. Can I come? So he brought me, and I saw a field of 100 kids, like, you know, training, playing, and I thought it was awesome. And so my initial lacrosse stint was after figuring that out. I volunteer coached at Notre Dame Prep for 2 years, and then got into the club lacrosse scene a little bit with Arizona Outlaws, which I ended up bringing both you guys in.
Yeah.
And it was actually the COVID year. I ended up moving in with two girls that were the assistants at ASU. And I was a volunteer assistant at ASU with the women's lacrosse program. So did that, and then the year after that, Brophy, you know, had an opening and applied and got in with Brophy. So really that first year and a half, I didn't know lacrosse was out here, so I kind of was on my own just training for my professional season, and then, you know, have been entrenched ever since.
I have two thoughts. One is, I remember first met you when we were doing Scottsdale United. I don't remember if we talked about this in the first podcast. Yeah. I don't think I told the story too, but so Steve DiBiase was the guy I was talking about who was running it at the time.
Yeah.
And when I had reached out to him, I was like, hey, I'm new out here. I want to help coach youth league. What do you got? And he's like, well, you can coach 7th and 8th grade with this guy, Pat Harbeson. So I look up Pat Harbeson, you know, UVA, played pro, champion, all this stuff. I'm like, oh, this guy's intense. And I knew he was slightly younger than me, kind of the same age, but I was like, oh, I got to, like, this guy. He means his business. And then I walk out of the field. I didn't realize how short he was. No offense.
Wow.
But I was like, oh man, this was not what I was picturing in my head when
that's crazy.
When I saw this. But But clearly much better athlete than I have ever been, and clearly in my current
state. So you weren't intimidated after you
Once I saw you, I was like, okay, I'm all right. I wasn't as intimidated.
Well, when I first saw you, baggy shorts.
I talked about the shorts.
Wearing all blue, baggy shorts, and I was like, this is going to be my assistant coach for the year? Great.
I talk about the shorts, and the kids nowadays, you know, they wear these short shorts. It's the style now. And I come out in my shorts that when I played, and they just make fun of me. They're like, what are you wearing? I'm like, this is what we wore when we played.
Yeah, but we need to upgrade your wardrobe.
Yeah,
a little bit.
Well, I'm slowly getting better at it. But so what did you think of your year coaching girls lacrosse?
I learned a lot. So the head coach at the time, Tim McCormick, he was a goalie at UMass, and then came over from Northwestern women's team. And the two girls that I lived with and coached with, Nicole Graziano and Dorian Van Dyke.
I know that. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, so continue. Dorian's a Long Island girl. And then Nicole, she played lacrosse at Florida. But anyways, like, I learned a lot. That's where a lot of my offense, concepts have actually come from. A lot of two-man game, a lot of pass, pick away. I thought the coolest experience was, like, Tim and the coaches, like, wanted me to suit up with the team. So, and I was preparing for PLL as well. So I actually practiced with the girls. I would bring out a girl stick. They gave me a penny. And then girls across, they have an extra player. I'm sure there is film. I could ask, you know, Dorian and Tim. But the girls have an extra player. So that was probably the biggest thing that I had to get used to, was having seven people on one side of the field at a time. So, but the girls' game, as you guys probably have seen, is a lot different, right? There's no pads, less, you know, physical. But I would still say, like, you know, they very much cross-check or cross-hold, I should say. But what I loved about it is the finesse. Like, all the goals are back doors or slips, cuts. Obviously, if you can beat your man, you know, take it to the goal. But a lot of it is team offense and trying to draw a slide and break down a defense.
Yeah, I think if you're a real fan of the women's game, you would say that's kind of the appeal of it, is the skill and finesse of that team sport. So I don't know if you know this. So I, as I just mentioned, I coached high school girls across for a year, but I coached goalies before. But I dated in college, was the starting goalie at Northwestern. She was there when that guy was there.
Tim.
Yeah, I'm okay. Pretty sure, because that was. They won one of those years, I think, right?
Northwestern has a history of just continuing.
But yeah, so that's funny. Small world. I didn't realize that, but I do remember, I think he was there when my girlfriend was playing. She was the goalie there at the time. So I got to watch a lot of girls across then, and I think the skill was the same. I think some people complain. If you're not familiar, if you watch it, there's sometimes a lot of whistles. And the game itself, I think at the younger levels, there's a challenge with that. We used to run a summer league, and one year we tried to do a girls' summer league on Long Island, because we had a lot of college girls coming back. We wanted an open division. And I remember one week in particular, there was some camp going on, so all these Division I girls were, like, in town, and they all came and played, and the refs who were reffing were, like, kind of keeping it pretty casual, and it was the best lacrosse I've ever seen. It was, like, the skill level and the ball movement and the athleticism was amazing. So I think shout out to any girls or women's lacrosse fans we've got listening. I think we've got some plans to maybe talk about that a little bit more too as we expand. But let's bring it back a little bit to out here and what's been going on. So, you know, I think one thing you guys were talking about before we even got started, and I'll take some blame here. I was a little late with getting everything set up and
hour
the pod,
and a half
pod
late.
Rolling. Well, you know. It's a Sunday. What do you expect from me here? Both of you guys are kind of offensive focused in your coaching and sort of offensive philosophy. You guys were talking X's and O's and things like that. So what would you say for kind of potential coaches or players even who maybe want to coach? Just high-level concept, what are you thinking about when it comes to offense? Like, what's the goal of your offense? Not necessarily specific plays or formations, but or you can talk about that. But, like, how do you want to score goals?
Well, I guess for us, Pat kind of alluded to it earlier, breaking down the defense. You know, you get some coaches who throw in these dummy dodges to start plays or start sets off. But for me at GCU, we're trying to score every time we dodge to go to the cage, because if we're not trying to do that, we're not getting the defense moving, we're not drawing a slide, getting someone a hedge to then have an opportunity to move the ball and swing it opposite and attack again. So we try and break down the defense every single time we go out there and start a play. And, you know, our offense is we have an initial dodge that we're going to the cage, and then we have a couple other things behind it. And then once we kind of get through that, it's just play lacrosse. It's you know, pass, dodge, two-man games, just whatever they want to do when they're out there. And they, you know, we go over the different philosophies and things we can do on the field. So when someone's dodging towards you, it's set a pick or clear through or do something where you're not just standing around. So, you know, once we get through our initial first looks in our set, it's just a free-flowing offense in whatever set we're in, whether that's a 1-4-1, 1-3-2, an umbrella look, 2-2-2, whatever it is. We're constantly going to the cage trying to break it down.
Yeah, and I like what you talked about coaching guys and planning for what you do when, like, the dodge is coming at you, right? Getting out of the way, you're clearing through, you're setting a pick. Like, there's too much. Sometimes I think at the younger levels, there's focus on just sort of what's happening on the play and the guy dodging and not necessarily what you're doing to sort of help with that. I'm going to put you on the spot here. Let's say you're in a game and you're struggling to – your dodges aren't working. Let's just say you're either overmatched or your offense is just, you know, you're not matching up well and you can't dodge. What kind of adjustment would you make? What would you sort of do?
We'd probably resort to some kind of two-man game. Bring a pick down, get someone else involved, so it's not just putting someone on an island. If you don't have a great group of guys who can dodge well, I wouldn't recommend an offense where you're soloing a guy out to make a dodge and try and start the offense. Because if they're not beating somebody, and the whole point is to get the defense to move and break down, you know, you're not really going to get much out of that. You bring a pick in there, and I think a lot of teams don't necessarily practice that two-man stuff, and especially if you're picking above the cage, I don't think a lot of teams work on that defensively, especially in the MCLA. So, you know, it's always good to bring someone else in there. Just run that pair offense all over the place, and I think that's your best option if you can't beat somebody on a clean dodge.
Yeah, I love that. I think sometimes, you know, I think you hear this in football a lot, where there's like a strategy and, you know, you got to adjust your offense and your defense to the players you have sometimes, and I think that's really good advice. There's probably some coaches listening, maybe coaching youth league players, and maybe you don't have strong dodgers or something, and start incorporating a two-man game and some picks, I think, is a good balance for that. So, I don't know. Pat, what do you think?
My offensive philosophy is, so, you know, similar to Cody's. Like, you know, I always teach, you got to dodge a score, right? You know, when you have a ball on your stick, it's, you know, you don't want to preach, you know, selfishness, but you have to be a little bit selfish, because if you can't dodge a score, one, and you're unable to create offense for yourself, mm-hmm. but also creating offense for others. And that means, you know, drawing the slide and moving the ball quick. I would say at Brophy, like, we play heavily in the two-man game, and, you know, for various reasons, right? You cater to the strengths that you have.
You've got a good skill, good team for that.
Yep, and we're trying to put the defense in a tough position, that we either throw a throwback, or if they slide from the crease, hit the crease. But a lot of our offenses have some sort of action on the backside, you know, either, you know, a seal, or, you know, it's just ball movement to get us to move. And I watch a ton of basketball. I follow a bunch of basketball accounts on Twitter and social media that, you know, you look at these offenses and, you know, a lot of cuts, a lot of seals, a lot of movement. And you look at, like, one of the best players in the entire world, Steph Curry, and I was telling this to, you know, a couple of our offensive players, like, you don't have to have the ball on your stick to be an incredible offensive player. In fact, probably some of the better or higher goal scorers aren't ball carriers. They're guys that are recipients of
crease guys getting open, just finding the seam, right?
Yeah, and I you know, so obviously I'm a Virginia fan. I went there. Yeah. But you look at Peyton Cormier, who is now the all-time leading point scorer at Virginia. The guy rarely carries the ball. He's just a menace off ball. And then, you know, to go back to the conversation you had with Cody about the two-man game, yesterday, Carter Schellenberg, a Towerton finalist, was going against Ajak Zapatello, probably the best defenseman in college lacrosse. And what did they do? They put him in a two-man because they wanted to try to get Ajak stuck on a pick or have to switch. And that's what you have to do sometimes. So, For us, you know, we preach dodge the score. You know, if we see a shot, we tell our kids to take it. You know, there is, I guess, like, maybe contradict myself. Like, I will say there's no such thing as a bad shot, but there also is a bad shot. We want high volume shots. You know, I say we want to be somewhere in the 40s and 50s. But, like, you know, there is a scale. Like, is this a shot one? Is this a shot two? Or is this a shot three? You know, a shot one is a great shot. A shot two is, like, you know, in between. And the shot three is like, hey, we shouldn't really take those shots. But, you know, just looking at our team right now, like, we have some great players. And, you know, I'm living in the moment and I'm thinking about this year. But, like, next year, it will be interesting because we do lose a Laird Miller and Eric Wolfson. And what does our offense look like? Do we need to restructure and cater to our strengths? But I think every great coach and great offensive coordinator – you know, they do a good job catering to their strengths and seeing the personnel they have and building an offense or a defense around the players that they have.
Yeah, I think that's big too. I mean, you know, you talk about shot volume. I think back to, like, when I was at Tufts and, you know, Daly at the time, you know, our head coach, and it was kind of a newer thing. I think there was some article that came out. I think it was two other coaches they were kind of interviewing or talking about, and just – we were a team that really focused on just kind of up-tempo offense. That was sort of our philosophy. A lot of transition, a lot of, you know, you talk about high volume shooting, but the right types of shots and things like that. And, you know, we used to always do this thing. I don't really see teams necessarily do this or talk about it in a coaching standpoint. I always think it's really good. It's something for, you know, listeners. We used to talk about up-tempo slow break. So you have your fast break, you kind of have your traditional L formation that's stood the test of time, I think, since the beginning of lacrosse, right? Like, that's probably one of the few things that has just not ever been really evolved too much. It just, it works. But what happens when you're running down and the guy gets in, it's a 4-on-4, something like that. We used to always run it where we bounce it back through X.
Slow break.
To DJ. Right. DJ Hester, who was this amazing feeder, and then everybody would kind of crash the net. And it was built into our kind of offense and stuff. And that's something I think a lot of teams, you know, can look at. Sometimes when I'm watching the ALL games and stuff, you know, the fast break's not there. They just kind of immediately settle it out. And there's nothing wrong with that. But I think a lot of teams would find some benefit to kind of finding, you know, that. I love that we have golf on in the background, by the way, for this, because I've been, you know, trying to work on my swing, as I've mentioned. And, you know, it's
the worst swing in Arizona.
I'm peeking in the corner. Honestly. I'm trying to kind of take some.
You go from slow break offense.
Well, listen,
to
it's a bonus episode. You're gonna get all walks of life here in our conversation. But no, that was I think really really good kind of offensive philosophy and sort of how to play there. So
I want to touch on the shooting.
No, you can't.
What I try and preach to our guys is we don't necessarily want the first shot. We're working for the best shot. So we get times where guys might think they have a wide open step down shot, but they're at 15, 16 yards, and we're not necessarily 15, 16 yard shooters. So, you know, it's don't necessarily take the first shot you see, or if you dodge down the alley and you're kind of running out of the angle, but your hands are free, you know, that would technically be the first shot to look for, but we don't want to take that because it's not going to be a high probability on that to score. So we try and really work for the best shot that we can out there every time we're working the offense.
You brought up Tufts. 2 years ago, I traditionally try to run a P40 showcase where I bring college coaches out here. And 2 years ago, we brought out Casey DeNolfo and then Danny Murphy, who's now the offensive coordinator of Vermont. But I remember during – we train and then we play games. And I remember during the game segment – someone on a fast break took like a really bad shot, and I was like, slow it down, why are you shooting that? And Casey turned to me and said, like, screamed at me, no, like, we want to shoot. And that just shows, like, you know, the Tufts mentality. Yeah. Like, you know, I agree with Cody. I'm probably more in line of like, let's work for the best shot that we can. But Tufts and other offensive coordinators, their teams, like, you know, they are believers in just shot.
Yeah, and that was kind of where the question came from, right? It's the idea of philosophy of, like, what you want to do. And you know, that's kind of live by the sword, die by the sword. You know, there's when you have players who can score from that, you know, you talked about Cody's 15-yard shots, you know. You don't really want that, but if you've got Joe Walters shooting from 15 yards away, like, you know, I'm probably, again, dating myself, my age and stuff, like, when I was playing. But, like, when you have those guys, I call them zone busters too, when you're playing against a zone, guys who could score from outside, then, you know, you can get away with that. Or, again, in my time playing, when we had DJ behind at X who could feed the ball and just tremendous. And yeah, shout out to DJ. Great player. Another, he was a Maryland guy. He went to St. Paul's. I think St. Paul's, right? Yeah. He was your, you don't know the school,
Pat? I don't know DJ, sorry.
No, but you know St. Paul's.
I know St. Paul's.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Well, we were a little older, but he was funny. He was I hope I don't get in trouble saying this, but he was your stereotypical like Maryland prep school kid. Tall, would always wear the prep school outfits, kind of lanky. Not, you would look at him and you'd be like, this guy's not an athlete. Like, he's one of the toughest kids I played with. He took a beating game in and game out. He drove to the net hard, and he was just, looks can be deceiving, man. He was one of the toughest players to play with. And I think he ended up, I don't know if he won player of the year or senior year. He was definitely an All-American, but really talented attackman. And, you know, I think he chose to go to Tufts because, and this is, again, for some of the kids listening, you know, he knew he had a chance to probably play all 4 years, which he did. And he was a smart kid. He was a biomedical engineer, I think, was going for school for that. So, you know, when we've interviewed some of the players, we've talked about what made you pick your college. And one of the things that they've all said, and my philosophy we try to kind of tell people too, is like, don't make your decision solely on lacrosse, right? Think about your future. Think about your academic opportunities. And lacrosse is weird because I've said this a lot. Division III teams, I mean, Tufts, Salisbury, you know, you've got, you know, Parker at your school there who's coaching, and Christopher Newport now, and what was the other, Stevenson's,
RIT. But
like those, the RIT, like those teams are could beat Division I teams.
Yep.
Like, you know, and it's a weird thing in lacrosse where because you've got restriction of growth at the Division I level for a lot of Title IX kind of things and funding and stuff like that, Division III, not exposed. Don't hit the mic. Sorry. I might have to cut that out now. Come on. That's all right. That's all right. It's good. It's a good pod. This is a good pod here, guys.
Well, actually, now that you're talking about schools and stuff and Division III, Division I, I'm going to kind of talk about the MCLA.
I was gonna tee you up for this, so go for it. Yeah.
So, I think the MCLA gets a little bit of hate because people are like, oh, it's club lacrosse, it's not that great, blah, blah, blah. But the MCLA there's a lot of talent in the MCLA. There's a lot of good teams out there, and it's going to be competitive wherever you're at for the most part. I mean, we just played Washington last night, and they had a grad student on the team who played at Stony Brook. So
yeah,
you're going to get, and even in the past when I was first coaching at GCU, we were playing against guys who were, you know, Division I transfers from some other big name programs playing at these MCLA schools. And I think the biggest thing about the MCLA is if you're a kid who wants to play competitive lacrosse, doesn't necessarily want it to consume your entire, you know, student life and your college life, then the MCLA is a good place to go because you're going to get competitive lacrosse. And it's also for that kid who doesn't want to go to some school in the middle of nowhere. I mean, think a lot of these, there's exactly a lot of Division III programs and Division II schools that they're like, oh, I can go play Division, you know, NCAA lacrosse, but then you're going to be in some middle of nowhere town, and your the only thing you got going on is just lacrosse. Yeah.
No offense, Colby, but...
And you're not gonna have some other sport there that you can go watch, some other big-time program. So with the MCLA, you get a lot of these big Division I universities that have big football teams, big basketball teams, who then have this MCLA program, and you kind of alluded to it with the Title IX and that kind of, you know, that aspect of it, where eventually those schools should end up getting into Division I lacrosse, I would think. But you're going to have, I mean, just thinking about the MCLA right now, the top 25, you're going to have Georgia Tech, Georgia, Texas, Colorado, Colorado State, UCLA, USC, BYU, Stanford, Liberty, Virginia Tech. You're going to have all these big universities where you can go play competitive lacrosse, not consume your entire life there, and then get to also enjoy the college life where you get to go to these big football games on a Saturday and enjoy all that. So I think, you know, that's, if I could do it again, I would have probably considered looking at the MCLA a little bit more if I had known anything about it. But I think it's definitely a great option for someone who wants to play competitively but not let it consume your life and get to enjoy school as well. So
yeah, and I think what helps with that is, and your school's a great example, these programs that treat it like a varsity sport, you know, like to an extent, right? Like you said, you've got a good balance, but
yeah, we've definitely toned it back a little bit this year from what it's been in the past, but we consider it like a you know, a top performing Division III program.
You recruit kids.
There's strength and conditioning, you know, we practice every week. And you know, on the recruiting side, the good thing about the MCLA is we can talk to whoever we want. We're not controlled by any kind of rules and regulations for recruiting. So we can go up to a kid at a tournament who's, you know, not eligible to be speaking with a coach yet and be like, hey, like, what are you thinking about? Are you considering going here, there? You know, we'd love to have you come visit, get on campus and see what we're about. So
yeah, that's awesome. And I think the pathway there is something that I hope they can get more of an opportunity to do. When you look at, I mean, look at ASU hockey out here. ASU hockey was a club program for years and years and years. They ended up getting some good donation money, and that helped them. But they went from club that took it seriously and ran it like club sport, like we're talking about a lot of MCLA programs, and now they're a Division I team that competes and is competitive with top Division I teams. And that's a pretty quick turnaround.
And the lacrosse side of things, you have Michigan. They were an
NCAA
Michigan
team. Was club. Yeah.
They were Utah. They were club. They just went Division I. So you get these schools that, you know, if they're worth going to, and then you recruit some more talented kids, and they can be a name in the game. It might take them a couple of years making that transition, but, you know, it's definitely a great option to look at.
Yep.
This guy disrupting our broadcast over here. That's it. Just lounging around on a Sunday, yeah. So that's great, and I love that conversation. I think, and that's I actually mentioned this in a broadcast last night, Cody, with your GCU game. I think one of the challenges for growth out here at lacrosse, and Pat, you know, you've been out here a long time. What you think too is that, you know, there's no NCAA team out here for boys lacrosse, men's lacrosse, right? You know, you've only got these club programs. You know, at least girls, you've got ASU, which is competing in NCAA, but you don't have a college team, so you don't have kids. We used to go to Hofstra games, Stony Brook games on Long Island. Obviously, where you're from, you've got Maryland, Virginia. You know, you've got all those programs. We don't have that out here.
See, but like, even though we don't have an NCAA program, we still have schools that are very competitive in college lacrosse.
But we've got to do a better job, I think, of exposing that to kids out here.
I think it starts with the youth out here.
Yeah.
I think they need to get exposed, well, and that needs to be grown. I think that's, getting kind of away from that, and not having an NCAA team, but that's really where the growth needs to happen for it to get to where it should
be. I'd be taking my youth team. I would be planning, and youth coaches, if you're listening, do this, and I'm happy to help connect and to do. I would pick a game, an ASU or GCU game.
It's free. You don't even have
to pay. Tucson guys, UA.
Christian University.
Yeah, I would be planning a trip and say, we're going to go to this game. We're all going to sit together, watch the game, cheer on this team. You are going to see good lacrosse. Like, that's the
I would also, I have a bunch of thoughts. I would also challenge those, you know, GCU, ACU, ASU, U of A. Like, I would advertise it a little bit better too.
Yeah.
Or reach, proactively say, hey, like, let me get the 14U Phoenix Titans. I want you guys to be our ball boys this game.
I love that.
You know, to do a better job. I would say, in regards to ASU women's, right, they're a D1 team, and you look at the success that Utah's had, Denver has had. Denver, their coaching staff also. Their coaching staff was. They led club programs.
Yeah.
The Denver Elite, that's Matt Brown. Matt Brown's the head coach who succeeded Tierney. He was ingrained in the youth aspect of it. Utah, they had Adam Gittleman, Will Manny, Marcus Holman. They all were Utah Summit guys. Like, they had a club, and they were actively growing the program or growing lacrosse in the area. So I would put a little – not that everyone needs a club program, and I don't think Arizona needs another club program at all. In fact, I'll talk about that in a second.
No, but there should only be like two, maybe three right now.
In Arizona, there should be one.
Yeah,
I was a part of it, right? So I was a part of, you know, for, I guess, guys that don't know, I partnered up with Casey Connor, who moved back to Maryland, and Ben Prepchuk, and we kind of revamped the Arizona Outlaws program. And for the time, I think we had a lot of success. You know, you two won Sandstorm 1 year and won a couple other tournaments.
Yeah, it was a great tournament.
And those players, you got...
We have good players. Dylan Finer going to Rutgers. Yeah. I talked about, not to interrupt you, but on the podcast last week, I told the story of me and Alfonso came to visit you at Rutgers, and we were trying to bring the couch in the dorm room. Yeah. So
the RA came out.
Yeah, yeah. So,
but going back, it's like imagine. And look, I was a part of it, so I will 100% take ownership of it too. And people run club programs for various reasons. You know, one part, to be honest, like let's be frank, is you know the monetary value. Yeah. To make some money in it. But if everyone is in it for the greater cause of growing the sport or getting kids to college, like put ego aside, put financial benefits, which would happen if everyone partnered up. Like everyone needs to work together in this state. That if we did, you wouldn't see guys going off to California to go play club lacrosse. You wouldn't see guys, you know, playing on outside club teams. I'm a firm believer, and I still believe it could be done. And maybe it takes, you know, guys like ourselves to do it, but there should be a like one team that, and it doesn't have to be for a whole summer or a whole fall, but you know, selective events that you're able to get the best kids together for, you know, a few events.
And I think maybe you start with just like one season, so like just do a couple summer tournaments, start with that, have, you know, as many teams as there is. You can have an A and a B if it's one travel program, and just focus on, okay, we're just gonna get a team together for these two tournaments this summer. We're going to start there.
Yeah, I think it should be like one or two selective to start. And, you know, maybe the other club directors can come together and say, hey, look, this is something that we are either going to send our kids to, or maybe take an even bigger step of saying, hey, let me go partner with the two other clubs and let's just do this all together. But, you know, it's also like, you know, politics, right?
Yeah.
It's like, hey, are we going to be able to get... Are we, you know, that's like saying the Republican and Democratic Party, hey, let's all come together. Yeah. Who knows if it could actually happen? It's a great pipe dream. But I do think, like, look, you look at the multiple club directors here, you know, Outlaws, you know, Ben Prepchuk, great coach, great offensive mind, has great, you know, is the only guy that's one of, actually, there's two guys that are doing box, and he's had a lot of success. Jason Anderson with Team 48, you know, they have multiple teams. In more of like a business mind, he's run that program really, really well. Dan Lannon, probably the guy that's been out here the longest with Hot Sauce, you know, has done a good job of, you know, fielding teams and providing a resource for players out, you know, more in the East Valley and in the Ahwatukee and Tucson, you know, group of kids. Dustin Cowell, who's the head coach at Arcadia, and Chad Tolliver, who formed No Excuse this past year. You know, they kind of, along with our mindset of like, hey, let's be selective and not go to the same events that all those other clubs teams are going, so we can maybe get the better of the kids. But, you know, I still believe that, you know, if all those coaches came together, you know, they might be able to have, you know, some of the best, all the best players together playing in one tournament representing Arizona. And in doing so, you know, I think it'll be a ripple down effect that, you know, more kids would end up playing and seeing the successes. And then, you know, for me, you know, now that I'm not a part of club, but seeing like with my ideology with Brophy is I want to send kids to college, or I, you know, I'm actively pushing kids to go play in college.
Well, you take Brophy to tournaments.
We take them to tournaments, but I want the Xander Welties, Cole Rassises, or now like the seniors that I have, like Noah Burdick and Charlie McGinnis and Eric, like, when they're done or when they're in college, like I want them to come back and lead camps, clinics, or shoot, even run a club or be a coach that can instill values or, you know, be that coach that kids look up to be like, this is why I got fallen in love with lacrosse. So,
you kind of touch upon camps and clinics and stuff. And, you know, at GCU, we run a summer camp, we run a fall camp, you know, a showcase, which was successful this past winter. These, you know, high school coaches out there should be pushing their kids to come to a clinic or a camp run by the college program in their town, you know?
Yeah.
Like when I was growing up, I'd love to go learn from college coaches and get that experience and get the knowledge I can from them. I think they need to really start pushing that some more, you know, kind of plugging our camp in here, but
Go for it.
We run a camp, and it's great. It's indoors in the summer, so you know you're not outside dying in the heat. And you know, it's a very educational camp. You're going to learn a lot, and I would definitely suggest youth coaches should be 100% pushing their kids to come to the camp. I mean,
well, what's your thought on, you know, I don't know how successful it's been in terms of numbers, but do you think there's resentment from coaches sending it to players, or do you think that players just don't want it enough to go, or is it a hybrid?
I think it's probably both. I think, you know, there's a lot of lacrosse not being as big as it is out here. You're only going to get a handful of guys who really want to go play somewhere or want to get better and learn some more. But I also think some of these youth coaches out here and high school coaches probably aren't even saying anything. You know, we reach out to every coach and say, hey, we're running this camp. It's great to get, you know, especially new guys starting out to 100%, they should be coming in, and if they really want to play lacrosse, learning a little bit. But I think it's definitely a combo of both. You know, I don't think it's pushed as much by the coaches out here, and I don't think lacrosse not being as big as it is, you're going to get kids who are just kind of playing it to play it, and the kids who are really into it, you know, they might show up, or they might just be like, eh, I don't need it. No, I'm good enough as it is. Like, I don't need any extra.
We're all kind of over the place, you know, just, and I love the conversation because I obviously love lacrosse and passionate about growing
this is great.
The sport. But the one thing that I've seen with these kids is, and I've experienced it with my own Brophy guys, is, you know, the second that Virginia, Maryland, Hopkins doesn't call, guys kind of are like questioning, do I really want to play lacrosse or not? And like, maybe I or us could do a better job preparing kids, you know, going into their recruiting summers and, you know, maybe be having more honest conversations of where they're at. But what I tell kids is, like, if you are in love with the sport, you know, kind of going back to, like, MCLA, D2, D3, D1, like, it shouldn't matter, right?
Yeah.
Now, if you're deciding between, hey, I'm going to Harvard for academics, or do I want to go to I'm making it up, you know, Scottsdale Community College and play lacrosse.
Yep.
Okay, that's a no-brainer. Yep. But, like, if you're in love with lacrosse, there's opportunities everywhere. And I think you should take advantage of that. I think a really good example, you know, recently have been, you know, a couple of the players that are seniors right now, Nick Miller, Aiden Ray, Will Elfline. Like, they're going to go to some good schools to go play lacrosse. And they're using lacrosse to get them there. So I just feel like this state is kind of like is interesting. It's like everyone says they want it, but when opportunities don't present themselves for like the top schools, then, you know, their true colors come out of like, oh, I only wanted it if I was going to go to Rutgers or, you know, so.
Well, yeah, if I can interject on
first,
that, touching on that, if everybody should kind of know where they stand talent-wise. If you're not a kid who's going to go to a school and go on to play professionally, then you should look for a school where you can play, and then also think about the academics too. And not only that, like, lacrosse is such a big network of people that it doesn't matter, you know, if you're going to a big name school or a smaller school, like, you're going to have opportunities to go on beyond lacrosse, which is ultimately the goal.
If you want to be in business or you want to be in finance, well, New York City is like the mecca of business. And guess who, you know, basically runs those firms? Lacrosse players, right?
Absolutely.
Like, every single kid that I graduated from Virginia is on Wall Street.
Yeah.
So
my guys are tough. A lot of finance guys, they all...
Exactly. So
I'm
trying to say is, like,
example,
you go to schools and you use the network, you use the relationship, you use lacrosse to get your next job, right?
Yeah.
Like, you don't need to go to Yale to go work on Wall Street. You could go to, again, making it up, the Scottsdale Community College and network your way to get to those same opportunities.
Yeah. And I want to, so there's, I actually have three things, but I'm going to, first one, real quick, the ball boy comment I think is amazing. And if I'm a youth program, I'm talking to one of these college teams, I'm saying, hey, can I bring kids to be your ball boys? And if I'm a college program listening, get a ball boy. We did it, I know our high school always used to grab youth kids to be ball boys on the end line at games and stuff. And I think the one of the challenges we've had in growing the sport, I've been out here for almost 5 years now, and I hate to say it, because when I first came out here, I was like, oh, lacrosse is growing, it's amazing. But if I'm being honest, and I'm also going to put it, for those who don't know, I am an ALL vice commissioner, so I'm, you know, technically part of all the structure of this, is that I don't think we've grown. I think we've been kind of stagnant. And And I think there's a lot of thoughts to that, and I'll get to it. And I think there's a lot of things that some are within our control, some aren't within our control. But I think the connection between college, high school, and youth, growing that connection and just recognizing, like, hey, what's the score of the game? Let's talk about it. Let's bring my team to the game. Let's get the ball boys. Let's do this. Like, where are you going to go? I think is a huge piece. But I want to go back to the recruiting and the programs for a second. I'm going to share a story. My college roommate, who I knew very well growing up, this is going to feed into a question I'm going to ask in a second. So Ryan Malloy, great attackman, went to Ward Melville. Family friend also, Cody, our dad, you know, he played with Ryan's dad in high school. They won a state championship at Sachem back in the day. Don Malloy was a great lacrosse player. He went to Hobart and played. Our dad went to Hofstra. Ryan was my age, played with him kind of growing up, knew him well, went to college. Like, he went to Tufts, and he had a very amazing, successful lacrosse career. If you recognize the name Malloy, you may know his younger brother, Dylan Malloy, who was a Towerton Trophy winner. Also good. I'm going to ask you about him because you played with him, Cody. But Ryan, you know, he works, I don't even know what he does now, but I know for a while he was a finance guy in New York City working and everything, and he did that through his program. When people talk about lacrosse, I always say this for Division III, everyone talks about scholarship. I got to get a scholarship, I got to get a scholarship. Division III doesn't have scholarships, right? There's no athletic scholarships to it. But what you don't recognize is that there are recruiting pathways for Division III athletes. Coaches have an opportunity to recruit players, and we're not just talking about saying, hey, I want you to come to my school, apply. We're talking about supporting you through the application process, understanding where you're at, and have slots to bring people in who may not get in on their own. That's just a fact of what recruiting is, right? That's what happens at every level. That's the nature of it. Like, the fact is, I get an opportunity to bring in X amount of players for a position. So what I tell these guys looking at schools is, just because you're not getting a scholarship, if you get an opportunity to go to a Tufts, and the coach is going to help recruit and bring you in, and okay, all right, I'm going to laugh at saying this. I'm sorry, Ryan. I'm throwing you under the bus a little bit. He was probably a borderline getting into Tufts guy in terms of on his own. If he applied on his own, he probably wasn't getting in.
I was not a Virginia guy. I had to do summer school 2 years in a row.
Yeah, yeah. Like Ryan got waitlisted, I think. Sorry, Ryan. But him being a recruit for that sport got him into a school where he got an amazing education and has a great career out of it. And that has nothing to do with a scholarship. Kids don't recognize that. So again, kids listening, like, the fact that you can get help getting into a school, and college application is a you know, competitive process, whether you're an athlete or not, you're going to get help getting into a school that's going to help your career. That's going to be worth more than $15,000 a scholarship every year.
Yeah, I mean, even at our level, the MCLA, like, yeah, we don't exactly have scholarships, but we, specifically at GCU, we have, I mean, they're technically not athletic scholarships, but they're these leadership scholarships that we can give kids, which would essentially just pay for the dues that they have to pay to be on the team. Now, of course, at the MCLA, I don't know how it is with every school, but I think just about every school probably has some kind of dues that the kids have to pay in order to get their gear and all those kind of things like that. But we have something where it's a leadership scholarship where you do some work outside of lacrosse, which helps build your resume for getting into the real world, and you get some money to cover your dues for the team. So, you know, it's everywhere has something that they can help people out with.
You have work studies for your scholarship?
Not with, like, we have.
You were too good for that.
But I know what work study is.
I had to do work study. I used to do laundry for all the athletic teams. Rory Doucette, who was our assistant coach at the time of freshman year, was running the laundry program. Shout out, Rory.
Rory was your assistant coach at Tufts?
Yeah, my freshman year.
The guy that runs Legends, though.
Yeah, because then he knows Zissi, Jono Zissi, very well. Like, they were boys. And Jono came on after Rory went out back to California. But I used to have, so work study was part of my package, right? So I had to do a work study job. I would sit in the athletic area. We had a laundry room, and all the teams, you get your little pin or loop, you throw your laundry on it. Oh, it was great. We had gloves. We did that. Yeah. But I would be the guy, I'd bring the barrels into the laundry, throw it in the washing machine, put it on, and I'd sit on the couch, watch ESPN, was first take, and not first take, part of the interruption and around the horn.
Nice.
Because I would do it in the afternoon. So that was my time frame. I'd sit there and do it, do the laundry, watch ESPN, do some work. That was my job. I got paid for that. So, you know, it was great. And then eventually we did, like, security at basketball games and some stuff at football games. It was fun. But those are things you get that I got, like, I don't know, $5,000 a year for doing that. Like, yeah. It was great.
I want to go back to your first – I know this was, like, topic two. I think you had one more, but I'll lose my train of thought. You mentioned, like, in Arizona, the pillars of college. I'll say MCLA college, right? High school and then youth. Like, I think, if, especially for someone like yourself that's on the ALL board and probably someone like myself that, you know, is doing a solid job at the high school level, like, there needs to be a leadership board or maybe, like, a leadership group on – you know, key initiative of growing the sport, right? So imagine, you know, either the head coach or the, you know, assistant coach of those college programs, a few individuals at the high school level, whether it's board members or teams or head coaches, and then the president of the youth league with people that want to assist need to sit in a room and say, like, one, are we all on the same page? Because I don't think we are, right?
Yeah, we need a
there's
summit.
There's three different entities, right? There's the MCLA, then there's the ALL, which is Arizona Lacrosse League in high school.
Yep.
Then there's the AYL,
yep.
which is Arizona Youth Lacrosse. Mm-hmm. And then, like, this is just the men's side. Like, the women's, I have no idea.
Exactly.
But in order for the sport to grow and in order for the sport to, like, you know, take a next step, like, we all need to be all on the same page if our goals are all aligned. And I would assume that GCU, ASU, U of A, ACU want to see the youth grow.
Yes.
Because they want to get, they want to be, you know, beneficiaries of future players.
Yeah.
Right. And I want to see the youth grow because I want, I don't have a youth program.
Yeah.
I rely on the Alatukis, the Phoenix Titans, the Scottsdale United, Desert Ridges to do well or introduce a sport so that kids want to apply and hopefully get accepted in the Brophy.
Yeah.
Like, so I think it all kind of relays, but I don't think we're doing any of that.
So I agree 100%. And I actually, I want to do some of this. I'd love to have, like, a summit of those leaders and get us together talking and figure out what we want to do. And then have something formal where we're kind of continuing to talk because I do think that connection is good. And I want to come back to one thing that we were talking about with even the club teams to an extent, but growth of lacrosse out here. What I think we've done a good job of doing is providing better opportunities for players who are interested in lacrosse, meaning you bring in guys who are professional players and do camps and tournaments and things like that. And it's great for kids who are playing lacrosse. But what I don't think we do is enough exposure to grow the population of kids who play lacrosse.
How would you do that?
You know what's an issue with that is, which I'll say, you're definitely not getting these other high school coaches of these other sports, football, basketball, wrestling, pushing their kids to go play lacrosse. And I think that's, as a two-sport athlete when I was in high school, that was huge.
I got a great relationship with my football coach.
Our starting football quarterback is
our starting defenseman.
Yeah, but then you got other teams where it's like, I mean, I'm going to talk about Pinnacle, where
you're not part of it anymore.
They're saying the lacrosse team can't use the turf field because they're going to mess it up.
Well, I heard that. And I also heard during weightlifting, a football kid that plays lacrosse too was wearing a lacrosse shirt, and the coach told him, like,
so
he had,
like,
a shirt, right?
I get it. Like, yeah, they should be in their football stuff, but, like, these coaches, and obviously it's different at Brophy because it's definitely the athletics there is significantly better than some of these other high schools out here, but those coaches need to be pushing their kids to be two-sport athletes. They can't be like, oh, you just got to play football year-round. Like, no.
Yeah.
You're going to be such a better athlete in football if you go and play lacrosse, too.
And yeah.
It's just, I don't think there's any of that push. And I think that's also because it's not a sanctioned sport. So
yeah. Well, I won't get into it, but I do think we're in a little bit of a chicken or the egg problem when it comes to this kind of sanctioning the sport of, like, you know, we've got programs right now that exist because you don't have to say anything. That's right. But we have kids who don't, you know, we have programs that exist because there's kids from multiple high schools playing together, which you don't have if we get sanctioned, but the sanctioning support. So there's a lot to that.
I think you don't have to be sanctioned, and this is obviously I'm on the other side.
Probably not, especially here because there's not that many kids.
Look at Dallas.
But look at Dallas.
Yeah. Dallas is growing rapidly, not sanctioned.
Yes, but what I'm saying though, to exactly what you're saying though, is the point is that we're not doing a good job, and I'm gonna put my AL hat on and say this, like, as somebody new in the program. We are not doing a good job of getting kids who don't play lacrosse exposed to lacrosse. And this goes back to the college thing, right? What do you see when you go out? You know, you know ASU football is playing. Do you know ASU lacrosse is playing? You don't know that. is we're not doing a good job of getting kids who don't play lacrosse to say, oh, that looks really fun, let me play it. And when I, all the player interviews we've had so far, when you talk to them, their story of getting introduced to lacrosse is, I saw this game going on, this looked fun, I went and did it. I got a good friend of mine whose son, and I remember talking to him, I was like, you got to play lacrosse, don't play, I don't know, man, I don't want to play lacrosse, blah, blah, blah. He eventually, the son, like, his friends were playing, he went and tried playing, and he's been playing it and loving it. One last thought, just going back to the club thing, right? So we talk about the club programs and things. Right now, as a business guy, if I put my business hat back on, there is a set population of players that we as club programs are kind of passing around and trying to sort of take those set players. What we're not doing is expanding our population of players who could join.
Well, if you're a club program director, it's like, and I was one, so yeah. It's my thought was I can't worry about trying to grow the game. I got to worry about the kids that are playing.
Yes, and that's the mission.
And get the best players, so I can field teams, go to be competitive in tournaments, and you know, again, like not to be shy about it. No. Have teams to make money.
Yeah.
Now, like I will say, every single youth program, like your goal should be, I need X amount of kids so I can grow the sport and build the program. For me, again, it's, and I think I need to do a better job of it, like either leading, more intro to lacrosse clinics, which we've done in the past with a couple of the, private Catholic schools in the area, middle schools in the area. But if I am, I'll make it up to like, I'll make it up North Tempe High School, and I'm a coach and I only have a couple players, or, I have the minimum amount of players to field a team. My goal is obviously to have a team in play, but isn't the success for the first couple of years. It's I need to go
need more players.
Partner with the youth or partner strategically with the high school and say, like, how can we continue to get more players if I want to have a team 2 years from now?
Yeah.
Right? Because you look at what has happened in Arizona the past couple of years, teams have fallen off.
We've been stagnant.
They've not only fallen off from a talent perspective, but they've... Teams have been eliminated. That's a numbers issue.
Yes.
So, like, don't worry about the success of 2024. Worry about, can I continue to grow the sport so that, in my area, more kids are getting sticks and hands, that I will have a team and I will be a head coach in, 2 to 3, 4 years from now.
Yeah, and that's, I think, the biggest thing for Arizona, and I hope to be able to do a lot of this. And we hope in a way that this podcast helps with that, is create something where kids... And we're biased, right? All three of us are biased in this. But to me, lacrosse is the perfect blend of sport that is skill-based, athletic-based, and competitiveness.
I don't even know if you say that's biased. That's just straight facts on that.
I mean, look at all three of us in the room. I'm the shortest in the room. You're
fattest.
Now you are. But you're frail. You got chicken legs.
Frail? I don't know. I mean,
Cody, you have good stature, but are you the best athlete? Yeah. Like, I don't know. But the sport... Yeah. Allows all of us to succeed because of one or two things.
And it's fun. And I talked about this with Matt McGinnis, Charlie McGinnis's dad, who you mentioned before. He's a defenseman at Brophy. He was a big time quarterback playing football, and he ended up committing to, he thought he was going to play football, he ended up playing lacrosse. He's committed to Hofstra. He's going to be a Flying Dutchman, former Flying Dutchman, now they're the Pride. But one of the things I was talking about with Matt was like, When I played, and Cody, you played football a little longer than I did, and Pat, you played football as well too and stuff, but like, football practices were not fun. Like, you played football for the games, those were fun, right? But
oh, absolutely. I wish I was athletic enough in high school to go and play, football somewhere, and lacrosse too. Yeah. It would be cool. I know there's a lot of guys that do that, but you don't play because you like the practice. Practices stink.
But lacrosse, like, people who love lacrosse, like, you love practice. Like,
practice is fun.
You're fun. Yeah. Like, the whole time is fun. And it goes to the club. The reason club lacrosse exists is because people want to play lacrosse. And they want to play at that level. So I think that, for me, and this is something I think bigger for us to talk about, is just how do we get people exposed to a sport that they're not exposed to because we don't have the direct high school connection and we don't have college programs. How many kids out here right now in Arizona are not playing a sport in the spring, or maybe they're running track or something, or I don't know, and they would be great lacrosse players, but they don't even know.
Yeah, well, we've hit a lot of this, you're talking about for a while. At the end of the day, like, I think it comes down to less talk, more action. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's something. I agree. That's something all three of us need to put our heads down and do. And the other reality of it is, in terms of sanctioned sports, like the next two sanctioned sports in high school are what? Let's take a guess. What do you think the next two sanctioned sports are in high school?
In Arizona.
Dude,
I don't even know what's not sanctioned.
Okay, next. Okay, go ahead.
Bro. I don't know.
Okay.
It's probably something random. Like
pickleball. That's
a high school sport. Out here?
Well, it's not, but I'm telling you, with the popularity of pickleball, it will probably be the next sanctioned sport. Okay, and the second one, any idea? Flag football.
Yes, I agree with that.
It 100% will.
I can see that
at the girls level first, and then boys. So we're talking about the clock is kind of ticking, right? You think of like an hourglass. Like we're gonna lose athletes to two of those sports. If we don't, kind of get our stuff together and try to, grow the game and help foster, some of these youth programs in the area.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. So listen, we've been talking for almost an hour, actually. It's been really, really good. And I had two ideas for kind of fun questions. I wanted to talk about kind of best players. Maybe we'll do this one quick. And then I want to have some fun with my old high school highlight tape, because I think you guys are interested. Not my high school, our team's high school item. I'm going to come back to that. But I'm curious. I want you guys to know, we asked Dylan and we asked Jake kind of players they've played against and who are really good, and you guys have played different levels. Now, Pat, I'm going to tell you to cut out professional sports from this one, because obviously everybody played the PLL and the MLL was great. But between high school and college, I want to know, who's the best player you played with and the best player you played against?
We might have to go to commercial break, because I got to think about this.
Well, Cody, I'll give mine.
Go ahead. You can go.
So I played against Rob Pinnell in high school. Okay. He scored a gazillion goals against me. Because this was, talking about growing the sport, back in Long Island, you would play summer league and indoor league. You had an indoor league and a summer league where you play for your school team. So you wouldn't play for club program. You played with Sachem, and we played Smithtown all the time. And I remember just playing against Rob my whole life, and I hated him, and he scored a gazillion goals against me. I met him more so later on, because one of my college teammates, Brian Donovan, was a good friend of him in high school. I met Rob and got to know him a little bit and didn't hate him as much. When I didn't know him, when he was scoring 100 goals against me, I didn't like him, but once I knew him, he was nice. But it's pretty cool to say I played against a guy who had the college record for most points, I believe, right? I think he lost it eventually, but he had it at some point, the most points. And I can say I had a couple saves against him. He had a lot more goals against me. But that was, that was big. I played against a lot of good players in high school too. I mean, in college, I played against the Browns. You played with them. I know their college career was not what I think people expected. But
no, their college career was fantastic. This is just the way that they ended. It was, it's sour taste. But I was going to say the best player I think I played against and with, because I practiced against him, was probably Shamel Brown.
Yeah.
Just obviously athletically extremely gifted, and if guys don't know who Shamel Brown is, go and YouTube really fast, because he's electric. Yeah. He was a lefty. Could dodge and shoot and score at any point, but also from a midfield, passing perspective, had just eyes in the back of his head and could find guys wide open. One of my best friends, Mark McNeil, played in the PLL, played at UNC, went to St. Mary's Annapolis. He was my rival in youth lacrosse. So from when I picked up the stick in sixth grade or fifth or sixth grade, he was he played for Davidsonville. I played for Broadneck. We would go at it every year. We're both in the same grade that people would always, talk about McNeil and Harbeson. And Mark is a 6'4" athletic athlete that played football and lacrosse at UNC. I'm a lot smaller than that, but Mark is probably the most athletic player I think I've ever played against, and is just a tenacious competitor.
What do you got, Cody?
Best kid I played against. I'll be honest, when I was playing, more so when I got to Hartwick, because I didn't really see much time at Rutgers in springtime when we were playing against other teams. And I don't even really remember too many guys that we played against. I never really focused on that, to be honest.
Well, you had the brother. Didn't you have Rambo's brother or something? Or am I making that up completely?
Rich Rambo?
Yeah, didn't you have a brother?
He was Matt Rambo's older brother.
Brother was on your team, right? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he was good.
Yeah. I'm just random.
I mean, the best player I played against, there's only one name that kind of rings a bell, and honestly, it's because like I recently saw that he made it to the PLL. Was Eli Gobrecht, I think his last name was. He played at Ithaca, a Division III school. I honestly, I never really focused on like specific guys that I was playing against. It was just, for me, especially at Hardwick, it was the teams we played against. Like, you had Nazareth, Stevens, Ithaca, St. John's Fisher. Those were like the top four teams in the Empire schools, 8 that would just dominate all the time. I think best person I've played with on my team, I would have to give it to probably Chris Aline, goalie.
My freshman year.
He was the Big East goalie of the year our freshman year. He was probably the best player I've played with personally. But other than that, it was more so just the teams we played. It was because there was never, I don't think there was ever really a standout person that we played against, an offensive guy on a team at Hartwick, where I was like, damn, like that guy, he's like.
Well, you played against Miles Jones in high school, and you were like,
Miles Jones in high school. He didn't really score much against us.
We had a pretty good solid shutdown against him.
He's a great player, but we shut him down.
You guys had a good game.
You know, some of the guys I played with in high school were solid too. I mean, you look at.
Well, you played with Dylan. We played young.
So,
but that's still is that it was before. It's cool before though to be able to say like I played with this guy.
Yeah, that was the Sachem and Ward Melville combined teams that we would have in the summer. That was fun to play with. But I think another guy that I played with in high school who ended up going on to have a great college career was Kyle Radigan.
Yeah,
he killed it at Limestone, and he's doing big things with one of the lacrosse programs back on Long Island right now, women's and I say girls and boys lacrosse out there. So I'd probably say those guys are pretty solid, but, you know, at the end of the day, I'm just going to go out there and play whoever plays against us. Yeah. I don't think, you know, there was definitely some studs in Division III, but we didn't really play against any offensive studs, I would say, that I was like, damn, like this guy's really good. I mean, if you want to go back to high school, other players that were really good I don't want to keep plugging the Pinnells, but his younger brother James Pinnell was very good at Smithtown West, and that whole team was pretty solid. But he was probably the best kid I played against in high school.
You played against Balcombe too at Sachem East. He's the goalie. He was good. Balcombe was good.
He went to UNC.
He was solid in high school.
His another, you know, fun fact. We talked about Malloy, the dad playing with our dad, Sachem High School. Kevin Balcombe, Balcombe's dad, state championship Sachem High School, 1979. Back in the day. And his son ended up going on to, he played at Smithtown and then played at UNC and won national championship. But that year of, so between Malloy, Petillo, and Balcombe, we had some good offspring who got a couple championships in the lacrosse world.
I forgot to mention, and this is sad because I asked our kids like if they knew who he was, but you know, it just shows how old we are, or just like again the lack of lax junkie, you know, that kids are out here, but like. Some of our players didn't know who Steele Stanwyck was.
Well, didn't I don't think did Steele's college career like he was great, but like
Steele won a Steele won a tour ton.
Maybe I'm so there you over, go. I'm over, falling into over the crowd. Rob, over into the
traditional,
crowd.
Yeah.
Over yeah. Rob,
traditional Steele was my age.
Over
was,
Rob Pinnell. No,
yeah, because Steele was
two years younger than you.
DJ, well, DJ played against him. I guess that's how I should know because DJ used to talk about how he played against Steele. But you're right. But that's
people don't you know, like. We got to have more lacrosse junkies out here. Like googling Steele Stanwyck. Yeah. And then the best goalie that I played against, that you guys might remember, Tyler Ferrito, lefty from McDonough. He played at
McDonough. Yeah, yeah. I remember the name. Was he Princeton?
He played at Princeton.
Princeton, right? Yeah. He was my age, I think. He was in my generation.
Brian, you're old. Okay.
I know, but these guys are. Listen, this is
stop trying to act like you're younger.
Right? Yeah.
He's a couple years younger.
Well, I was Scotty Rogers' year.
Okay, like I said, you're old.
Yeah, like I remember Scotty, and we were in the national championship when they were in the national championship. Oh, so no. I remember walking by him in one of these games, and I was like. Or after one of our practices, I think pregame, and he was like doing an interview in the hallway or something. I was like, "Holy shit, this guy's huge!" So, and he was a typical Long Island, like he was a typical Long Island. Yeah, just leave it at that. He was a good Long Island. All right, so we're pretty much at our end here. Now I want to do something fun here. Now Pat, you got a high school team here, and you've had some great social media presence in terms of guys who've been able to make videos and kind of document your career coaching, like the coaching and team career of your high school team. John, one of them,
For Hosha.
Yeah. Sorry, John. I never knew how to say your last name. But great guy. I know John. You know, he does this amazing stuff. It's amazing nowadays what people have, these high school kids. And this is part of what we want to do the podcast for, right? Is to give exposure to all this stuff. And I share stuff from some other social media pages. Scottsdale High has some good stuff. West Valley's always messaging me things. Like, we want to share all this stuff. It's amazing to see. I went to the archives, and I pulled out Sachem North High School, 2007, highlight film. Now, I crunched this down. This was a 25-minute highlight film.
I'm not watching 25 minutes of you.
I crunched this down to about 10 minutes. This is not me. This is our team highlight film. And I'm going to – now, if you're watching on YouTube, I'm going to try to splice this in so you can see this. If you're on Spotify, you're only going to be able to just kind of you'll have to listen to it. But so if this is the end of our verbal conversation, we're going to add this in. I think we've got about an hour. This is really good. But I want you guys to watch what highlight films look like back in the day. And I'm going to try to share this here. Hold on. We might.
Hey, everybody. Here's a little just transition here. So if you're listening to the episode on Spotify, you won't get to see the video we're talking about here. If you do watch on YouTube, we're going to splice in the video. So chance to switch over if you haven't. If not, I think you've heard a good portion of the podcast. So we really appreciate everybody listening. And if you want to see the highlight film that we're going to reference in this next section, check out our YouTube podcast version. We hope you enjoy it. Thanks, everybody.
All right. So we had a little fun thing here. So I have been surprised by the level of amazing video and behind the scenes stuff that you have, Pat, with Brophy, thanks to John. And who does it now for you?
We have a guy named Adrian Chandler. On Instagram, he's Ballhog AC. Great guy. Comes to our games, practices, does some content for us, yeah. But yeah.
And you know, Cody, you had some stuff here too. So I thought it'd be fun. We'll do a little bit of a little time capsule here. Let's go back to 2007, my senior year of high school. This was our highlight film. Now, I cut this down, and I also want you to imagine that and this is no shade to the guy who made this highlight film. This is just a recognition of what things were like in terms of technology and music and things like that. So here we go. This was the 2007 senior Sachem North highlight film here.
Just so everyone knows, this is Brian trying to...
We are going to cut this in. If you're watching on YouTube, I'm going to try to slice this in.
Brian's just trying to pump his own tires.
Yeah. Here. This is what we had back in the day. I feel bad. We're gonna get the audio music on here, but the music is part of what we wanted to capture.
You just want to watch yourself playing the cross again. It's okay.
I do have the best highlight. This is how it starts, by the way.
What number are you?
The crowd.
What number were you?
I was 18.
18?
I used to... was so excited to get that white and black jacket down there.
Is that like if you made varsity, you got a boathouse? That needs to be something. We got to talk about boathouse jackets. Kids don't know about those.
Oh,
yeah. We had the all-black boathouses.
That went on for 2 minutes. Just the parents in the crowd.
And then now they're going to film you guys warming up?
Oh, just wait. This is great. This is a 20-minute video.
Was your dad one of the coaches?
Yeah. I'll point him out when he's in there, too. That was the head coach, Jay Morrow. Matt Moffitt on the right. He played at Duke. He was a war medal guy. This was us. How tough did he look?
I mean, some of those guys had zero till.
Those are boathouses.
18?
I think I was in the front. He missed
it. Did you play with Brian? Yeah.
Nah, yeah. He's...
The metal studded piece.
Compare this to the stuff John does. I mean, the music, the...
There you are, the jacket right there, John.
Yeah, well, I was trying to stay warm all the time, you know?
Soft. This is 07? Okay.
2007.
So this would be my freshman year of high school lacrosse.
PAL complex.
Look at this defensive drill.
Look at this.
We still do that drill.
I know, but this is like, look how bad. I went back and I was like, wait a second, we weren't bad, were we? And then I'm like, I don't know, maybe we were. Like,
yeah, this is...
This is left hand though, too. This is our lefties, so, you know.
Any studs out here?
Let's see who's on my team. Well, John Trussello went to Brian. Ionello, Anthony Ionello. I've mentioned him on the broadcast. He reminds me of Noah, or Noah reminds me of him. He's in there.
He's some I'll terrible shooting.
This is our... We were also middle of the road team on Long Island. Cody's team was much better than me.
All right, so when you say middle of the road, you guys actually suck.
Well, we got killed by West Ice aboard Melville, but we played everybody else really well. So, you know, the usuals. But, I look back and I'm like, maybe we did suck.
Yeah, you guys sucked.
Like, maybe we
no
did.
No one can shoot. Maybe also, like, I don't need to watch 5 minutes of guys shooting into a net.
Maybe I didn't. Oh, shit. Hold on.
The black CPX is the goal, too.
Here we go.
There's Brian right there.
The head coach, Jay.
Long Island accents.
This is my dad here.
That's your dad?
Now again, I get that. I did shorten this. This is only less than 10
also,
minutes.
Also, no one knows how to spell highlights. H-I-L-I-T.
Listen, I'm not trying to shade the guy who made this, but, you know, just listen to the music.
Nice save.
Also, this
nice
is the, save, this is the Coach Petillo, Brian Petillo highlights here, so.
Oh, gosh.
This is me pumped up here.
Brian, you're pretty good.
Brian's talking
this
trash.
Guy, 24, was the skinniest guy I ever played with, Kevin.
You're
Kevin
the skinniest
Van.
Guy.
He was a
wait,
dirty.
You had two goalies?
He was.
Is that you?
Yeah, they put the backup in on some of them, too. But
let's be honest, you were the backup.
No. High school, I actually played. Dominic was good, though. Dominic was good. But Kevin Van, 24, skinniest guy, with the dirtiest players. He butted in the shit out of people. Like, he was.
That's a Long Island guy.
He was a Long Island guy, true and true. You look at him and you were like, oh, this guy, he's not a tough kid. Skinniest, least, now, I think he got into big into like CrossFit. I think he's like huge now. But.
You had two good goalies.
Yeah, Dominic was good. I don't know whatever happened to Dom, but. This is good. There's only about a minute of this. So
he comes out of the cage pretty quick.
Yeah. He I think, had a lot of potential to be really good. That was, there was something. Okay, so the other thing is like, we released this film. The first time we see it, and you're going to see it more in the second part, is I think our awards dinner. And it gets to a part where they talk about like body checks. And it's our guys getting like body checked.
It's weird seeing you be athletic,
right? This was my
so Brian,
prime.
When can we get you back in the cage?
Look
me
at
and,
these shorts,
me...
man. Look at those shorts.
That's crazy.
When can me and Cody shoot on you?
Yeah. I honestly look at that and I'm like, this is easy. I can do this again. I'm going to have to. All right, so we got, it's like a minute of scoring here.
I mean, I don't want to see you guys score.
But, like, look at this compared to what you guys put out. How lucky are these kids nowadays? And that was part of the thing was, like, for the podcast was to, like, show people a chance to get recognition. Like, this is when we played. This was the extent of what we had for our highlights and stuff. Like, this quality.
That's pretty sick.
We had some good kids. We gotta wait till we get to the body check and those. It's hysterical. That's the guy who reminds me of Burdick, by the way. Noah, this is Anthony I know of. He's a short guy. He's a wrestler. Great LSN for us. Really good in ground balls. Threw a lot of trail checks because he can't move his feet and stay in front of the guy. Sorry, Noah.
That reminds you of Noah? That's messed up.
No, that was a joke. I think Noah's... Noah's a great, great defenseman. That team was horrible. That was Riverhead. They were trash. There you go. That's the Noah guy right there.
Hopefully this first one is yours.
We were so bad, dude. We were a middle... Cody's team was much better than we were. Like I said, we were a middle-of-the-road team. But our high school split, so we had a whole high school team that split into two high schools. Pretty much my sophomore year, so that guy went to Bryant. Okay, so listen to this. Just listen to the music. We have stick check section with Akon. Smack That as the song. Then we get the body checks. This is good. Crush up. So we're watching this award dinner. Let the bodies hit the floor. First clip is our guy getting fucking plowed.
That's crazy.
That's absurd. The guy watching is like, why would you put that in?
It's all of it. You guys are all.
Oh, it's a mix. It's body checks, getting and. But I also think about the reffing, and I watch this game, and I'm like, oh my god, I couldn't imagine out here like what these are called. Half of these are penalties. This is Long Island. Objection. This is Long Island tough lacrosse here.
Was that West Islip?
East, Half Owl Hills.
That's the thing about watching these guys. Like, these guys look like grown men in high school. Yeah, some high school
this
nowadays
is penalty.
Like small.
It's on the highlight film. Our guy getting slammed.
Who put this highlight film together?
But
who's Mark Kenny? He's Kenny's dad. No flag on that, by the way.
It's like the old football NFL highlight videos on the hits.
You're all jacked up, right?
These are NFL refs. These players would be kicked out of the game.
Well, this was, let's see, we were tough, man. This is Long Island, man. Like, Sachem was always known for being a, you know, tough team. A lot of football guys, a lot of guys who were, you know, scrappy.
No call, love it.
Oh, lots of no calls, yeah. Love that it. Would be a call in your, in the AR. Yeah. We're almost done. There's only 2 minutes left. We're good. The best body check is is me or the end, though. I'm just gonna.
Of course, that's why you're showing us.
That's why I'm showing it.
It's all about you.
That one had a flag there too. That might have been Palisek actually, because I think it was Rocky Point.
That was great. It was only just a play on.
I love that he scored and they put that in there too. Yeah. Andreassi, he was a meathead.
No flag. That's
no
sick.
Flag. Yeah.
I wish it was like that nowadays.
That one got a flag.
But I love how there's no retaliation. It's like, yep, this is tough.
This is tough. That was it. It was just like, that was how you played on Long Island, you know? Look at this quality, though. Like you have John making amazing videos for these guys. This is what we had.
Surprised they had a turn back then.
Almost done. I think the next one is my, it's going to be great pod when you watch this here.
It's tough. Kids were tough back then.
Yeah.
Oh,
this,
tough like this anymore.
Is this it? No. Yeah. With that said, we were a good team. I think we were a good team back in the day. No flag, though. No flag.
I love it. Let the boys play.
Lasorda right there, 22.
Lasorda, going back to the Bratton. He played not only against Lasorda was this great running back, defense back, football, great athlete. This is it. Here we go. This is my highlight of my high school career. Hold on. Give me the arm.
Hold on, a little trash.
God, that's crazy.
That's pretty much it. I think that ends it there. Then we cut into the city. Oh, we gotta get the flag raising, though. Hold on. Get the flag raising.
There we go.
This was,
shout out to Andreassi raising the flag.
So, welcome to what we had for our lacrosse highlight films back in the day. But, all right. So, I think that was a pretty good session here. I appreciate you guys joining us for a good little Sunday morning lacrosse talk. I think we hit a lot of good topics. I think we got a lot of stuff still to talk about. The pod's going to grow. We're going to talk about more of this stuff, but I appreciate you guys joining us here. I hope you all appreciated the time capsule back to before we had high definition cameras on our phones and editing that didn't involve, you know, word art of Sachem highlights and things like that. So Any last thoughts for the group here, Pat, Cody, since you got a chance to talk to everybody today?
Nothing that would get us going, not get us going back down into some other big topic.
Yeah, we're
going
to have episode 2 in the off season or something.
Yeah, I would just say, you know, less talk, more action. So if our thoughts are to grow the game of lacrosse, then we need to put our heads together and do something about it.
Awesome. Well, I love it. Well, thanks everybody for tuning in this week. A little bonus episode. We'll try to do some more stuff like that in the off season, but.
Real quick, who does GCU play next?
We play U of A down at U of A this coming Saturday.
And then when's your next home game?
The weekend after that, we're in Southern California playing Chapman and San Diego State. And then I believe it's the weekend after that. I get a quick confirmation on when our next home game is. But for sure, like, get out there. Watch us play.
That's what I was going to say. So maybe Brian.
If you want to watch the broadcast, yours truly does some color commentary.
We have a.
So check out APN video.
April 6th and April 7th, we have two home games, one against UCLA and one against USC.
So
get out there. Come watch some college lacrosse and see
maybe
what the NCAA
maybe it's something
about.
That the podcast promotes.
I think we might have to get some boots on the ground and record out there maybe and promote it.
So let's do this then. Let's. Cody will be there, so maybe me and you plan on being there, and we'll do an in-person three-way interview with an Arizona player, maybe a high school guy.
I love it.
Boots on the ground.
I love it. Let's work on keep growing this game here. That's great. And then, Pat, Brophy, you guys got – I mean, we have a big ALL matchup this week on Friday.
So you
got another game.
Yep.
So we got – you're the coach.
Friday –
you're not looking ahead.
No.
You know you got to take care of business there. But if I'm a fan – as a fan, I'm looking to that Friday game. I know everybody loves hearing me on the color commentary, but I won't be on the matchup Friday night. So we will still broadcast it. You'll still get to hear Matt McGinnis do the play-by-play there. And we'll have Brophy versus Notre Dame Prep, the other undefeated in state. It's a St. Patrick's Day, so we're at the end of the broadcast here, and we've been,
Friday, so I'll finish this off. This is Pat Harbeson. Tomorrow on Monday, we play Foothill from California. They were the CIF champions last year. Going to be a tough opponent. Come out. It's at 5 o'clock. And then next Friday, we play the other undefeated team in the ALL conference, Notre Dame Prep. Incredible team. They have Cooper Perry, 5-star wide receiver, number one football player.
He's a 5-star wide receiver?
Number one recruit in Arizona.
I didn't know that.
So he's a dual sport athlete.
That's awesome.
A tremendous lacrosse player. It's going to be a tough game. It'll come down to, whatever team stays more disciplined and makes more plays. So this is Pat Harbeson signing off on the AZ LAX Report.
Anyway, I will say one more thing with GCU. Check out the GCU Lacrosse Instagram page. We do our games are live streamed. For the most part, either that or mclatv.us if you want to watch us play these upcoming weekends. We got
awesome.
Some good games.
All right. That's a great podcast, everybody. Have a good week. And let's keep growing the game. Bye, everybody.